Good morning. My name is Doug Shaw, and I'm a senior advisor here at the Nuclear Threat Initiative. And I'll be the moderator for today's session with Dr. Vincent Intondi. Please note that we are recording this session so other folks can watch it later. And if you'd like to ask a question, we'd be grateful to hear from you. Please use the Zoom question and answer function, and those questions will be forwarded on to me. We're honored and excited to host Professor Vincent Intondi here to discuss his new book, Saving the World from Nuclear War, the June 12, 1982 Disarmament Rally and Beyond, published last week by Johns Hopkins University Press. This is an important new book, in the words of Ray Acheson, the director of disarmament of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, that shows how social movement rallies and campaigns are not just discrete moments in history. They're created by the relentless organizing of those seeking to make change in the world, and their legacies can impact movement building far into the future. Dr. Vincent Intondi is a professor of history at Montgomery College in Takoma Park, Maryland, where he founded and now directs the Montgomery College Institute for Race, Justice, and Civic Engagement to educate students on the importance of social justice and working to make Montgomery College, the community, and the country more equitable and just for all. His last book, African Americans Against the Bomb, Nuclear Weapons, Colonialism, and the Black Freedom Movement, was published in 2015 by Stanford University Press and established him as a leading authority on the intersection of race and nuclear weapons policy. In terms of the agenda, Dr. Intondi will speak for about 20 minutes and then take questions from me and the audience. And you can submit your questions via the question and answer box at the bottom of the screen. Please include your name and affiliation. And just a note, to remind you that today's event is on the record and will be recorded. Dr. Intondi, thank you so much for being with us today. We welcome your remarks.
Thank you so much. Thank you to NTI. Thank you, Doug. I know so many of you over there, and I'm really honored that you guys are having me here today to talk about this book project. So let me begin with a few words here. I will not only kill them, I will kill their family members. The United States must greatly strengthen and expand its nuclear capability. Let there be an arms race. We will outspend Russia and China into oblivion to win a new arms race. These are the words of former President Donald Trump. And while in office, he repeatedly threatened to use nuclear weapons, talked about resuming nuclear testing, and withdrew from numerous nuclear weapons treaties, including the Iran nuclear deal. And so when Trump was in office, many for the first time started thinking about the issues that one individual could end life on the planet and that nobody could stop him. We started seeing a heightened awareness of all things nuclear when he was in office. Add to that North Korea, add to that China, add to that Putin's invasion of Ukraine. Even New York City had a PSA on what to do if there was a nuclear attack. And so this got me thinking, can and should people organize around fear? And I believe that you can, but only if you also offer hope, which is why I started writing this book. Throughout the nuclear disarmament movement in the 1980s, and especially June 12, 1982, there were a few things that I really wanted to highlight with this book. And one was that the movement has always been more diverse than previously talked about. When we look back at this time period, when we look especially at the June 12th rally, it was led by women, the LGBTQ community, African-Americans, people of color, and this is often ignored. They, again, are not seen and not heard in the disarmament movement, and representation matters. When we are younger, we look in history books to find somebody that looks like us, shares a common ancestry with us, that we can identify with. And so it's important that we make sure that this narrative includes those who were so instrumental, especially at the height of the 1980s. I wanted to show younger organizers, younger scholars, that the same issues they're dealing with today are not new. That issues of racism and homophobia and misogyny and patriarchy, these things existed back then. And how did organizers navigate those issues then so that people could learn from it today? I wanted to show that back then they were able to put 1 million people in the streets, the largest single rally in United States history. And they did it without a cell phone. They did it without email. They did it without any social media, and yet managed to organize so many individuals. And I also wanted to show that grassroots organizing matters, and that indeed it did move the needle on the Reagan administration and what they were doing with nuclear weapons. So when the United Nations announced they were going to have their second special session on disarmament, this is what got people thinking, organizers, about doing something big. But first they had to reawaken, because throughout the 60s and 70s, many peace groups, many of the nuclear disarmament movement had shifted their focus to trying to stop the Vietnam War. Not only that, coming out of the 1970s, there were so many people that were just simply exhausted, fatigued from the women's liberation movement, Stonewall, civil rights, Vietnam. You had people that were suffering PTSD as a matter of this war, whether they were veterans or they were people trying to stop the war. People had to go underground. People had to flee the country. They were in prison for crimes they didn't commit. And all of this was happening while the right was resurging, while the right was getting really good at direct mailing campaigns and merging with the moral majority. A perfect storm was brewing. And so if we were looking for one word to reignite the anti-nuclear movement, it was Reagan. When Reagan comes in, he thought armed control was appeasement. There was not a single treaty that he actually backed. He was in favor of, he falsely asserted the US had unilaterally disarmed in the 1970s. He surrounds himself with people like Gene Kirkpatrick and Caspar Weinberger and William Casey and Vice President Bush and so on, who all talked about a winnable nuclear war. If you go back and you look at his confirmation hearings for his cabinet members, many of them were saying that we can win a nuclear war. Not only that, that if only 10 million people die, that's not everybody, so we should be okay. If every citizen has digs a hole and has a door to put over it, we give them enough shovels, we can survive a nuclear war. This was the rhetoric coming out of the Reagan administration. And not only that, he backed it up, because he spends over his two terms $2.7 trillion on the military, much of that on an MX missile program and more nuclear weapons. And while he does this, he doesn't raise taxes on the rich. He goes the opposite way and cuts money for the poor. Children in poverty, millions of them. In parts of Detroit, in his first term in office, one third of the children were dying before their first birthday. And so in addition to that, we have a whole culture of nuclear fear that is forming in the 1980s, much like we saw during the Trump administration. Books were coming out. Over 130 anti-nuclear books came out between 1979 and 1983, featured on Time magazine. Two of the most notable were The Unforgettable Fire, which showed drawings by atomic bomb survivors, and of course, Jonathan Schell's The Fate of the Earth. You had things like the emergence of MTV, which if you watch MTV back when they were actually showing videos in the early 80s, you couldn't get away from nuclear weapons, whether it was a video from Genesis or Sting or Men at Work. You had Three Mile Island happening in 1979, which again raised the attitudes of all things nuclear and heightened that awareness. And so this movement awakens, groups like SANE, UCS, PSR, but new groups, Athletes United for Peace, Architects for Nuclear Disarmament, Nurses for Nuclear Disarmament, Dancers for Nuclear Disarmament, we're all getting involved now in this issue. And women, again, were leading the fight on this. Most notably, two women, Helen Caldicott and Randy Forsberg. Helen Caldicott, who I interviewed for this book, was of course known for being president of PSR and for creating WAND, Women's Action for Nuclear Disarmament. But the key to Helen Caldicott was her charisma and her ability to talk about the human consequences of nuclear weapons. She got a Hollywood agent, Pat Kingsley, and was able to get into Vogue and Ladies Journal, Beyond 60 Minutes and Good Morning America, show upon show where she would just talk about as a physician what was actually going to happen to people. And that resonated in a big way. And of course you had Randy Forsberg and the Freeze Initiative. A lot of people, when they write about the 1980s, only focus on the Freeze Initiative. And I wanted to be clear in this book, especially from all those that I interviewed for this, that the rally on June 12th and the movement in the 1980s was more than just the Freeze Initiative. Although that was a very important tool and very successful, it wasn't the entirety of the anti-nuclear movement in the 80s. But the key to the Freeze Initiative that Randy Forsberg creates to not test, produce, or deploy nuclear weapons resonated with the American people. In fact, by May 1982, 83% of the American public wanted the freeze. And what was so genius about it was you didn't need a physics degree to understand it. It was in simple language. Like Malcolm X used to always say, make it plain. You don't need to use the fancy jargon. You don't need to be wonky in terms of reaching the American public. And it also provided agency, right? And that's an important piece of this, giving something tangible to people so they could bring that to their city councils, their mayors, their governors, get it on ballot initiatives, feeling that they're actually doing something to try to stop the arms race. And so when the UN decided they were going to announce a second special session on disarmament, a veteran activist got together and decided to do something big. Now, there's still those that I interviewed that said, I started it. No, I started it. But most of the people I talked to all said, who cares who was the first person to start it? That's an ego thing. It was a collective agreement that we should do something big about this. But if we're looking for some of the organizer, if you will, the person who was keeping this all together, it was Leslie Kagan. Leslie has been an activist and an organizer throughout her whole life, still active today in New York City. And like many of the organizers of this rally, grew up with the nuclear threat. Parents were active in this movement, grew up with civil defense drills, grew up during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and knows all too well about these issues. Kathy Engel, who is an amazing writer and poet and professor at NYU right now, she was very young at the time, and she was tasked with being the person to get Broadway and celebrities and musicians involved in this, which was going to be crucial. I can't press upon you how important the art world was in this rally and in the 1980s. And also Riverside Church, William Sloan Kaufman Jr. and Cora Weiss leading the charge over there. In Riverside, we know mostly from Dr. King's speech in April 4th, 1967, his Beyond Vietnam speech, where he argued that the United States was the greatest purveyor of violence in the world. And so when this starts to happen, when they start to plan this, that's when the real hard part begins, because when you have so many groups now being part of this, and so many individuals, some seasoned activists, some who are younger, this is when now you got to figure out, what are the slogans going to be? What are those committees going to be? What are we going to have task force? What are all of these issues? And this is where race comes into play. This is where intersectionality comes into play. So for one, there was a real issue of, should this be a single issue rally focused specifically on the UN, what was happening in nuclear weapons? Others said no. That when you looked at the money and where that was being spent, how it's hurting the Black community, when you looked at what was happening in El Salvador at the time, when you looked at Israel invading Lebanon at the time, there were those voices that said this must be combined with these other issues. And the Black community, led largely by the Reverend Herbert Daughtry and the Black United Front, the Third World People's Coalition, they adamantly believed and argued that race should be a part of this. And as a result of this, as a result of all of these kind of tensions, at one point, the rally almost doesn't happen. There is what's called the corporate coup by most of the organizers I spoke with. That was led by Cora Weiss. And some of the more pacifist groups decided they were going to completely eliminate anyone who was deemed too radical, the Black United Front, those that wanted to combine these issues. And there was a point where this was going to just completely collapse. And they managed to keep it all together. But that, again, was largely because organizers came together and decided that 50% of the leadership that day would be African-American. Even task force, there were things that there was no LGBTQ task force among all the others. And when those who were gay at the time asked why not? Well, some of the people said, well, that was because we don't want to alienate the Catholic Church and religious folks. But in the meeting, there were actually a couple nuns in there, Catholic nuns. And they said, don't put that on us. That's not our issue. We don't care about that. and they actually did get an LGBTQ task force. So a lot of these things were happening and were being organized. And again, they're things that we also see happening today. And when I ask folks like Randy Keller and David Courtwright and David McReynolds about the issue of intersectionality, some said, you know, we don't want to have an alphabet soup where you just have every single issue, every single cause there, and then you don't know, you know, who gets on stage and does the message get lost. But then later in their years of thinking, they admitted that, yes, these things are connected and that it can't be a single issue. There's no way that you can ignore race and gender and all of these things that go along with it, economics. And so it's pretty amazing that they were able to pull this off. And I don't think any of them realized it was going to be, again, the largest single rally in U.S. history. Because don't forget, you also had massive rallies supporting this in Europe. You also had a sister rally that went on the week before in California. And so they get there, Leslie and some of the others, they get there around 7 a.m. at Central Park. And they see how many people have spent the night. They get word about the buses and the trains all being sold out all over the place. They're told of people that are biking, that have been walking from all parts of the country, people coming in from Canada. You have the Habaksha that are coming in who almost didn't get here because the U.S. government enacted the McCarran Act and tried to stop them from getting here. And so you have the Habaksha coming in, Filipino delegations coming in. All of this was happening. And when the rally begins, you start to see now all the celebrities pouring in, you know, Meryl Streep and Roy Scheider and Orson Welles and Yoko Ono. Orson Welles gave one of the most passionate speeches there that day. And again, the art world was so impressive because you had a Broadway and dancers putting in the playbills, pieces on nuclear disarmament to attend the rally. What Kathy was able to do was she got poets, established poets on every corner leading from the UN to Central Park. So imagine hearing these poets. They had bread for puppets and they had paper mache. They had all of these things happening. You had groups like Sweet Honey and the Rock and Chaka Khan and Rita Marley and Gil Scott-Heron on stage performing. Coretta Scott King speaking. You had thousands of African-Americans coming out of Bed-Stuy in Harlem. Two members of the LGBTQ community spoke that day on stage. And of all the speeches and the songs and the atmosphere that day, it was one of hope. From everything from the weather to the interaction of people, even the police. Police were interviewed saying, we care about nuclear disarmament too. And Helen Caldicott, when she gets on stage, she always kind of ad-lib, never had anything prepared. And the main thing, the line she said that resonated and really made all the papers was, quote, there are no communist babies, there are no capitalist babies, a baby is just a baby. And then Randy Forsberg went up there and a key line she said is not only that we had done it, but we will go home and organize. And that is where the Freeze Initiative was also so important. It gave those people that were there something to do to go home and organize, not just end at the rally. There were tens of millions of petitions that were flown in from Japan to bring to the United Nations. And when it was over, all of these people, many who never even made it into Central Park, and there was not a piece of garbage to be picked up. It was as clean as could be afterwards, which just reflects kind of the atmosphere of that day. And a lot of people forget about 2 days later on June 14th, when there was a huge act of civil disobedience, a sit-in. It was called the blockade of the bomb makers. And it was planned out ahead of time for who was going to get arrested and so on and so forth. And so looking back at all of this time and this particular history of this rally, this march and what came of it, and why the book has And Beyond in the title, is because I wanted to look at the legacy of this. What lessons can be learned for younger organizers? Because some argued it was a failure. You could say that there was no major consensus document that came out of the United Nations as a result. The arms race, you can argue, didn't stop. The officials in the Reagan administration said he was at Camp David. Nobody was paying attention to these people and what was happening. And you can look at what's happening today, where we could argue we're as close as we've been since the Cuban Missile Crisis to nuclear war. In fact, just yesterday, you have Lindsey Graham going on TV saying if President Reagan was here today, he'd be shooting down Russian jets as we speak. But the reality is, years later, everyone from Nancy Reagan to Reagan's director of public affairs, to his chief pollster, his NSA director, Secretary of State George Shultz, Caspar Weinberger. They all, years later, said they were absolutely aware of what was happening in the streets. They knew that they had to change course. They knew what public perception was. So I would argue that, yes, it made a difference. Every president is pushed to act on any issue. And Reagan would not have acted if he wasn't pushed on this. And so the sad part is we could have completely eliminated nuclear weapons. We know now that Gorbachev wanted to do that. If Reagan would have kept his ridiculous Star Wars plans in the laboratory for 10 years instead of in space, and Reagan refused at that golden hour. But in 1987, we do get the INF Treaty, and that is significant. It matters. And part of that is because of the work of these individuals and ordinary citizens. When I interviewed the folks that I interviewed for this, they had mixed feelings. Some felt they did fail because of all the work they've put in and where we are today. Others, though, explain that it's not just about moving policy. You know, when I was at the last year at the first meeting of states parties for the TPNW, and reporters asked me, did I feel that it was successful or not? And I said, I don't know yet. We need to see what the younger folks do when they leave here and how they organize. But what was evident was all of the young scholars and people there from around the world that were so happy to be together because they realized they weren't alone. And that's the importance of rallies like this. Sometimes just realizing you're not alone in this struggle, which is so difficult. And you could also argue that we went from 70,300 nuclear weapons in 1986, and we now have 13,100 in the global stockpile. Is that not success? But the real proof of the success of this is in how we view the nuclear disarmament movement. And we should be viewing it as a long movement, not compartmentalized. It begins in 1945 with atomic scientists, with the Catholic Church, with the Habaksha, with those in the Black community. And without those folks, you don't get Women Strike for Peace. You don't get organizations like SANE and UCS later on. Without those folks, you don't get June 12th. You don't get all of these groups from around the world participating. And without that organization, you don't get the TPNW and ICANN today. So it is a long progression. And the ultimate proof of what they did in June 12th, 1982, is that here we are in 2017, when 120 nations, mostly from the global South, get the TPNW ultimately into force a few years later. I wonder if those folks in June 1982, if you asked them about having a treaty, a legally binding treaty to ban nuclear weapons, if they would have believed that would have happened. But here we are. And it's a lesson, it's a tool, right? Not the be all end all. It is a tool to use to stigmatize nuclear weapons. Again, as if the NPT is the cornerstone of disarmament and arms control, then I say the TPNW is the capstone, and we still have a lot of floors to fill in. And so the lessons that I hope that people will take out of this book is that there are more of us out there, that you have to provide agency to folks, that you can organize around fear as long as you're providing that hope. So can this be done again? I don't know. Things have changed, technology now we have, you know, maybe we do something different, something better, who knows? But what I hope is that when people get done reading this book, they are educated, they are motivated, and they are inspired to once again raise up that anti-nuclear banner. And writing this book and throughout this process, I was constantly reminded by the words of Audre Lorde, that survival is indeed the greatest gift of love. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Dr. Intondi, for those impassioned and energetic remarks and your incredible scholarship that underpins them. And thank you especially for celebrating some of our heroes. I was particularly pleased to hear you call out Dr. Helen Caldicott, who I've been privileged to work with on several occasions, and Dr. Randy Forsberg, who I never met, but of whom I am something of a fanboy. Her work was really transformational, and remembering her, I think, is very important. And she doesn't appear in many scholarly works on nuclear deterrence policy, but really had quite a role. Thank you for calling out these heroes. where should we be looking for heroes today? And are there things that we can do to prepare, protect, and elevate them?
Thank you for that. I think obviously the obvious answer is looking for heroes in our young folks. That's the obvious, and organizers. And to protect them and to help them is to make them feel safe, but also make them feel wanted, make them feel that they have a place in our movement, in whether that's in the NGO world or whether that's in the organizing world. But it's not just the younger folks. I think that we can find heroes today in older folks, obviously, people that are established, people that can train and mentor these, take them under their wing. I think it's not just one thing. It's not just the grassroots, although that is important. We need to find our heroes again in Congress. For a long time, the Congressional Black Caucus led the fight on this. We need the Ron Dellums back. We need the Harold Washingtons back. It can't just be Barbara Lee or Ilhan Omar or a Jamie Raskin or an Ed Markey or a McGovern by themselves. So we need to champion those that are willing to take a stand against nuclear weapons and back them. We need to find the funding to elevate those that are doing really scholarly work as well. There is a place for that, right? So I think there's all different avenues. The art world, there are people that are doing great work in the art world. Look at On the Mooring You Wake and Games for Change, what they were able to accomplish with a VR experience. So it's helping those people that are looking at different ways, different ideas of how we can get people involved in this. And then of course our educators. We need to really help educators beyond the college professor, the high school teacher, the elementary school teacher, the junior high teacher, how we can help them get this stuff in their curriculums. How do we help them build their lesson plans? How do we help them in terms of giving them resources so that they can then get this into their curriculum so that students aren't going 18 to 19 years old without ever learning about an issue like this, so that they're coming to this movement already with a knowledge and a passion to wanting to do something. And of course, the biggest heroes of all are the atomic bomb survivors, without question. Thank you.
So you mentioned the cultural salience of nuclear war in the 1980s. MTV was certainly vivid for me. You mentioned 130 books published from 1977 to 83, which including Fate of the Earth, which is obviously culturally very important. I'm reminded of the paperback copy of Harvard's Living with Nuclear Weapons that's still stamped East High School from where I stole it when I was 15. There was a flourishing of thinking about the danger nuclear weapons posed to humanity at that time that is absent today. And I'm wondering if you have thoughts about how we can rekindle it.
Yeah, so something that I've always kind of had to tackle with both books is, do I write for a strictly academic audience or do I write for a general audience? Who am I trying to educate? What am I trying to do here? And I've tried in both cases to thread the needle so that my books can be assigned in undergraduate courses and in these types of things, but also for a general public. And I think that's a difficult one. I understand that people need the line on the CV. They need it for maybe tenure, and I get the academic journal piece of it. But even for me, it was hard as, when I was writing for the Huffington Post, I would write an academic journal that you'd spend all year on. You wouldn't get paid for it. You'd go through all the revisions to get it in a journal that three people are going to read, but I have a line on my CV. Great. And then I'll write a 700-word essay on nuclear disarmament in the Huffington Post. They'll tell me that 300,000 people just read it. Well, who am I reaching? Now, I know that Huffington Post isn't going to get me a job, but who am I trying to educate? And so I think we need to look at that in terms of our writing and what we can bring to the table and how we, who our audiences are. And then I think we need to look at how we can get things done for, again, a younger age. So what I mean by that is we have found a way to tackle really hard subjects like the Holocaust, like slavery, the Middle Passage, and write children's books, right? So that they're digestible and we can use them as a learning tool. We haven't done that with nuclear disarmament. Why? We can figure it out. We have enough educated people we can fit in our movement to figure this out. So we need to figure out a way how that we can, get that again into younger hands. And then lastly, you think of something like The Day After, right? Where 100 million people watch it and so on and so forth. Well, I'm hoping that perhaps maybe the Oppenheimer movie, Christopher Nolan's film that comes out in July, could be a springboard for us. Why don't we have, you know, if there's a, we can do screenings of it, but also that will be the time for experts like yourselves and others to get on the mainstream media, whether it's the writing the op-eds in the major newspapers or getting on television and say, okay, this film's come out, now let's talk about it and use that as a springboard to get people interested. We know Nolan's gonna make a good film. If he follows Marty and Kai's book, it's gonna be on point. So use that as a way then to get people, you know, that are gonna be maybe for the first time learning this to say, okay, here's where we are now, here's what you can do about it, et cetera. So I think those are some of the ways that we can get that back, you know, into our, into the zeitgeist.
Thank you. Dr. Intondi, one of the many important contributions of your scholarship is careful documentation of intersectionality in nuclear disarmament advocacy over decades, over generations. My observation today is that nuclear deterrence policy is more segregated than ever from broader social and political issues. And I'm wondering how this disconnection emerged and what can we do to correct it? How can we bring those the energy of a very vibrant culture of political activism into the conversation about nuclear deterrence policy?
Thank you. Yeah, it's a tough one. And, you know, before it was even a buzzword, if you look over me, you see the poster, official poster of June 12th, and that's actually in the book. And I interviewed the artist that made it. And if you see it, there's five distinct legs coming out of the dove of different races and clothing and shoes. And he, of course, did that because he saw it as intersectional and that he wanted to make sure that also it represented different groups of people. So a couple of things. One, when I get asked, some people said, well, have told me the reason that that there was this kind of intersectionality back then and not today is because they don't have the issues that you have today. And I push back on that because there was certainly issues for folks back then. You had an AIDS epidemic, you had a war on drugs, you had rampant police brutality, abject poverty, you know, the LGBTQ community, the civil rights community, these movements, they just simply switched lanes at this point because they realized how crucial it was. Now, it is hard because I will have students now that say, Prof, I'm working two jobs, taking 15 credits, have student loans, trying to help my family out, trying to, you know, work maybe on climate change. Oh, and by the way, you want me to stop nuclear war too? So I get it. And again, the age old thing of nuclear deterrence or nuclear disarmament, again, is a hard sell because you start talking about ICBMs, you start talking all this stuff, the kids, they glass over and it's not tangible. You know, again, climate change, you can see the fires, you can see the earthquake, you can see this stuff and you know you can do something about it. That's harder to do with nuclear disarmament. So that's the hard part. And I think, you know, is you know, kind of cheesy as it sounds, one part of this is branding. It is marketing. It is making it cool for these kids. And I think that's something that ICANN has been brilliant on. And so I think, you know, I did a talk not too long ago and they said, we're really all about reaching younger people. But the song they played for my entrance was Pete Seeger. Now I love me some Pete Seeger, but if you think that's gonna bring young folks in, they don't. You're not, you have to change and adapt and say, okay, how are we going to do this? And so that's the longer conversations we have to have. But again, it's, when you see yourself in this fight, you know, I can't press upon you over the years how many students I've had that have had no, they could care less about this issue. And then when they come to it and they go, wait a minute, I didn't know Malcolm X cared about it. He's a hero of mine. I didn't know that, you know, Angela Davis or Lorraine Hansberry or these people cared about this issue. They buy in. Or I point out to them, hey, you know that hip hop artist you really like? Look, really listen to his lyrics and see what he says. And they realize he's actually talking about nuclear disarmament. But I didn't see that. I didn't hear that. You know, there's ways that we can do this. There's not going to be just one approach to each individual, but we got to start thinking in different ways than kind of the usual things, because, you know, it doesn't seem to be working all that well right now.
Thanks, Dr. Intondi. We have a question starting to come in. I have one here from Ambassador Susan Burke. She asks, incorporating nuclear weapons history into curricula in schools at all levels is a challenge, but an area where progress can be made. What more do we need to do to make this an element of positive political discourse, not a debate about how many more weapons we need?
Great question. Thank you. And this is where I'm, you know, to be honest, dedicating most of my time right now is creating this. Because what we can do is, so the first thing is schools are so siloed of STEM and humanities, which makes no sense to me, right? But that I see it all the time. You're either studying in the humanities or you're studying in STEM. Well, a student who's taking a physics course, why they are not taking a course on philosophy and history and learning about nuclear weapons and the humanitarian aspects makes no sense to me. So we have to break down those walls. Now we have to provide the teachers with the resources so that if you're a music teacher or an art teacher and you want to incorporate this in, we need to show them how they can do that. What are the lessons? What are the books? Who are the people they can bring in? How can they incorporate this into an English class, an art class, a music class, et cetera? Those are the types, but again, at a younger age, we need to go into marginalized communities and get this into the curriculum. Now, how do you do this? Well, first of all, you got to have data. So maybe you go, since we're in, you know, in this area, you go into the DC public schools and you start collecting the data of how many teachers would like to incorporate this in, would they be able to incorporate it in? Now, I understand what curriculum, you got to make sure this goes around outcomes, it goes around Common Core, it fits into all of these types of things. You might have to start with a private school. So you start these things, you have an institute or a summer institute where you have teachers, especially those that are ignored in marginalized communities, where these teachers can come and learn about these things and how they can incorporate these things into their curriculums and why it's important, why they should buy into this, why it matters to them. Teachers unions, you work that way. You go to the national high school social studies conferences and things of that nature and present. So there are multiple ways that we can do this. And there's a lot of folks working on youth education. Masako over at MIS is doing great work. The Stanley Center does great work in Iowa. Rebecca Irby does great work in New Detroit. But the problem is that's not getting out to other constituencies. So for example, my students who don't come from means, if I say to them, have you ever thought about going to Middlebury? They have no idea where Middlebury is on a map. They have no idea it even exists, right? So we gotta start much earlier to get this in the curriculum. So again, when my students, my freshman and sophomore come to class and I say, how many of you have read John Hershey's Hiroshima? And they go, what's that? That's part of the problem, right? So we've got to figure out, and again, it can be done because it has been done before. It's going to be obviously a harder lift in places like Florida for obvious reasons, but that doesn't mean you can't start in more progressive areas and set the model. Once something is in the system, it's a lot harder to uproot it out. And so that's something that we can work on together.
Thank you, Dr. Intondi. Melvin Hardy from the Carter School for Peace asks if you could speak to the theological underpinnings for nuclear weapons abolition.
Yes, thank you, Mel. So religion has been a piece of this. It's in my book here, how important the religious community was in 1982. The religious community was, again, throughout since 1945 have been a piece of this. And so there's been different things. There's been the more apocalyptic narrative that has been talked about in different faiths, in churches. Do we have essentially enough faith to keep us out of this hell and what's happening? We have had, especially in the 80s, there was not this, you had churches coming from and faiths coming from all various parts of the country. Again, with the idea of you can't possibly say with a straight face say you're pro-life and be okay with nuclear weapons, right? So we saw, nuns, priests, pastors, we saw all of this, Buddhist monks, Hindus, all coming together. And there were interfaith, and I write about this leading up to this, there were interfaith conferences and convocations and all around the nuclear issue in the 1980s. So I think, again, now is a time for us to revisit that and to go back into churches and say, why is this not something? We can look what the Pope has said in his statements, right? We can go into different places and talk about the history of Black pastors, not just Dr. King, but so many others, and what they have said about this issue and how they tied it into their faith. So it's something that's always been there. There's been great books written about it, extensively. Robert Holdsworth comes to mind. I think that, and I've made a point in both books to make sure that the issue of religion and faith and theology, a social justice gospel, liberation theology is all part of this.
Thank you. So we've got an anonymous question that just surfaced that I feel particularly drawn to, which is, what about the role of young people and others in the rest of the world? And, you know, I think of this very vividly because there's a lot of positive energy around the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, obviously. But that's, it's distant from the nuclear weapons policies of the nuclear armed states. And, you know, creating a more inclusive conversation seems to call for greater connection between young people and the rest of the world with this incredible danger that's, you know, of which only a few states are custodians.
Thank you. I think when we look at the rest of the world in terms of younger folks and their engagement, it could be similar in the United States as a microcosm, that I think that you have a lot of younger folks that are involved, but they don't feel seen or heard. And again, they're not connected to other folks. At least that's one thing social media has helped with. And again, I was able to witness that at the first meeting of states parties. Why I come back to TPNW is because it's global in nature, right? So that kids or younger folks in countries that have been ignored and the nuclear powers have kind of looked at as very condescending. Your opinion doesn't matter because you don't possess nuclear weapons, because you're not a major player in certain issues, right? So you're beneath us. Now with the TPNW field, they're part of this, right? It's their country championing this. So I think that's why it's important. The other piece though is if we want younger folks from around the world to really be invested, then we absolutely have to do something about this visa issue. Because what I witnessed at both in Vienna and what I witnessed in New York at NPT, the amount of visas that were denied from younger scholars from Middle Eastern countries, from African countries, was appalling. And so if they can't even get to sit at the table with civil society, then how can we expect them to actually care and want to be involved in this? So that is something that we absolutely have to address going forward.
So Dr. Intondi, you touched on something that I feel very sensitive to, which is the condescension, and in many cases, explicit condescension towards the parties to the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons and to people from parts of the world that are not represented by a nuclear arsenal. And that's vivid in Washington policy discourse, right? So going beyond critiques of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons and its process and its methods to dismiss the premise. And I'm wondering if there's anything that can be done to combat that explicit condescension, to make it more costly to dismiss this objective, which is in fact, of nuclear disarmament, which is a long-term goal of the United States government.
Yeah, again, I think, in the DC area, or just, you know, the NGO world and policy folks have to say, okay, we're at this moment where we're having a real reckoning on everything from representation and a lack of diversity to gender, to where money's coming from, especially now with MacArthur, and where, you know, what were the funding issues, where should we best spend our time, research money. And if we just keep saying we're not going to look at any new approaches, right, we're just going to have this attitude of no, because the nuclear powers are going to boycott this and aren't privy to this, we're not going to look at it. We're just going to kind of do the same thing as normal. It's clearly, again, not working. So let's try again to not just dismiss something new. Let's say, okay, how can we work within that structure? How can we look at some new voices, some new ideas in these types of things? Because again, we're also dealing with, you know, the UK, the French, the US, who have a history of racism and slavery. We have a history of colonialism. Russia with its own internal history of slavery. I mean, so the utter contempt of life, in many cases, Black life, right? And so we need to be honest about this is our history. And if this is the history of our country and how this bleeds into militarism and nuclear weapons, then okay, maybe we need to start looking at different approaches here because this simply isn't working. And again, especially when we look at how little money there is at this point, in our world. How then, right? We can't all, we have to look at even different revenue sources. And so that means reaching out to different groups. And I've always said, well, we talk about education. Well, instead of all fighting for a slice of the pie of, you know, Prospect Hill or Plowshares or Carnegie and all, well, what if we were to reach out and work with marginalized school children in a place like Akron, Ohio, and really teach them about this issue? Well, then you can go to LeBron James Foundation and said, we're trying to get these kids jobs and cohorts, and we're trying to show them, you know, work with STEM, and that might open things up. Like, there's different places we can look, and that can add to this again. And again, at the end of the day, it's about looking and being open to new approaches instead of having this condescending attitude of, well, you're not at sitting at the table, and we're not even going to let you at the table, so too bad. And to me, that just doesn't, we're alienating such a percentage of people that are brilliant, but just because they don't have the degrees, maybe they don't have the pedigree, whatever, their voices aren't being heard. And to me, that just, you know, and something so crucial as this, we want as many voices as we can to hear their ideas and their ways we can change this.
Thank you so much. You've triggered one of my pet fantasies, a daydream about having a sort of Dora Milaje of elite nuclear deterrence strategists grown up somewhere where you wouldn't expect it and intruding into the discourse that excludes so many people today. So we've got some great questions coming in. I've got one here from Joe Cerencioni, who one of the longtime heroes in this space, particularly I recall his extraordinary work with the campaign for the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty in 1994-95. Joe says, fabulous talk, thank you. Do you think that the nuclear disarmament movement has missed an opportunity to advance these issues during Putin's war on Ukraine, when more people are worried about nuclear risks than at any time since the 1980s?
Yes. Short answer. I think when I see all of this happening, especially with that, and you know, for the first time, I had students that were saying, you know, Professor, are we going to World War III? Are we going to have nuclear war? Is Putin going to do this? What do we do? Is then Israel going to hit Iran? What happened? That fear is happening, right? And so instead of just having people divorce themselves from it because they say it's all madness and I can't, you know, as we're coming off COVID, the economy, I just can't deal with it. Now would be the time to harness that. But again, that's the fear. Now we got to figure out what is the hope we're going to provide them, right? So we have to figure out a way to provide agency and hope. Now, are we going to get a million people in the streets for this? No, but we can say, okay, what can we do in terms of more than just social media? And those are the things that we should be sitting at the table together and saying, okay, what can we do to harness what's happening right now? And I think the key to that is giving, again, people a feeling that they can do something. That was, again, what the freeze was so great at. And that's what climate change has been able to do, right? Now, again, I know it's harder with us, but being able to say, I stopped Keystone from being built. I stopped Standing Rock. I did something. These kids feel that they did something tangible instead of just recycling, you know, plastic. And so that's what we need to figure out is what is it that we can do so that they can feel that they're doing something tangible to stop this madness instead of just kind of divorcing themselves and waiting for this to happen. And so that's going to be everything from providing those resources and ways that they can do something to educating folks about what is actually happening as well. Again, in a digestible way, not in some wonky way that they're not going to understand, right? So how do we get it to them in a way they can understand? So yes, I think that we need to, sadly, I don't think it's over. And I think that we need to use this time and say, okay, there's fear there. There's an awareness there. What do we do with that, you know, and go forward?
You make a really important point about highlighting the many fights that have been won in the nuclear disarmament movement. You know, I think there's a reductivist approach to nuclear disarmament that paints it as one naive thing, and nuclear deterrence can be anything it wants. But and I think that sort of misdefinition is a real obstacle, but can be combated by painting, as you have done in this book, the many victories of the nuclear disarmament movement. Carl Robichaux from Longview Philanthropy asks, well, first observes, thank you for your scholarship and public voice. I just ordered a copy of your book, so that's good. My sense is that one of the reasons the 1980s movement was possible was because there was a clear ask, stop the arms race, that ordinary people could get behind. People have status quo bias, and they could get behind a message that was about stopping a dangerous attack on the status quo. Is there an ask today that will seem reasonable, realistic, and desirable to ordinary folks? This is something the broader arms control and disarmament community has struggled with in recent years. I think it's especially hard because the U.S. lacks willing partners in Russia and China.
Great question. The first, I'd like to go back to what you said at the beginning of that, Doug, which was about the perception that it's naive to talk about these things as being possibilities. You know, a couple of years ago, I gave a commencement address at SUNY Oswego, and my message to those students was to be naive. It's okay to be naive, right? People in the civil rights movement were naive to think that they were going to get equality, right? But they did, right? I mean, they got the Civil Rights Act of 64, Voting Rights Act of 65. You know, people were naive to think we would, you know, win an 8-hour workday or have this thing called the weekend. But we got it because they fought for this, right? So we can look at, you know, historically movements that you look back and you go, they were really naive to think they were going to pull this off. And they did. So you hope the same would be for this. Yes, it's absolutely harder in the nuclear disarmament world on the ask, because as we've tried over the years, do we ask to eliminate ICBMs? Do we ask for a no first use policy? Do we ask to change sole authority? For us, those are reasonable asks, and we know about them. Again, you go to a high school kid, you go to a freshman in college, and you say, we're going to ask for no ICBMs. You have to explain what an ICBM even is. So we're starting, those aren't things that they can grasp onto. So, you know, is it that we find a new freeze movement and try to do it encompassing, but then again, you don't have China or Russia as part of this? Do you use the TPNW and use that because of its comprehensiveness? But the other piece you could do the ask is divestment. What they did in New York City was incredible. To get over $450 million divested from the city pension fund from nuclear weapon making producers, that is something you can do. You can do that at the college level. You can do that, you know, at the pension level. You can do that where you can start a divestment campaign. And that may be something tangible that, you know, is that you can explain to folks and they can really get behind. But the problem also is how much of a jobs program Raytheon, Boeing, all these companies are, right? So you're competing with that as well, where you might go into a smaller town and now you're competing with people that say, you know what, I'm with you, but this is my job. What do you want me to do? They're not ideological about it. It's a jobs program. So now you're competing with that. So it's not easy. There's not a silver bullet. And as much as I would love to say, this is the thing to do to stop it tomorrow, the reality is we have to accept that what we're doing is not for our generation. That's the reality. That when we're not here anymore, nuclear weapons are still going to be here, sadly. But if there's less, and we've helped make a dent in that for future generations, people's kids, grandkids, so that they don't have to live in this fear of dying from nuclear world, then that's all we can do. And so that's what we have to think, that fighting for a future generation, it's not a reason to fall into despair. It's actually a reason to dig in even harder. But that's on our fight. This is where we're at.
Thanks, Dr. Intondi. You remind me of, you know, in my household, it's common to talk about the ICBM after next as something to focus on. Patricia Jaworek from NTI asks, you mentioned the environment of polycrises we currently live in, climate change, etc. How can we best capture people's attention to nuclear disarmament in this context and create an atmosphere of hope you mentioned was so vivid at the rally?
Again, different ways. Thank you for that question. So I may be talking to a student or a younger organizer who I know loves sports. And we're talking about LeBron James, we're talking about Kaepernick and socially conscious athletes. We talk about Muhammad Ali, we talk about 68 Olympics. That's my opportunity to now bring in Athletes United for Peace and all those athletes that cared about this issue. When I'm talking to parents in a marginalized community, like I often would talk about years ago when I was in Baltimore and they didn't have heat in the city schools, so they told parents to bring in space heaters. And when I'm up there talking to those parents about spending $1 trillion on nuclear weapons, even though I understand the money's not just going to flow that directly, they realize they have skin in the game now and why they should care about it. When I'm at a cancer walk and I'm in the conversation now about thyroid cancer and what happens to Native communities and nuclear testing and the legacy of that, they now realize why they care about this issue. There's not going to be one way. Those students that love graphic design, video gaming, that's where you bring it on the morning you wake, right? So it's oftentimes I have students say when I'm advising them, okay, what do you want to do? I want to help people. Okay, how? No idea. Now let's talk about these things. So you've got to start from there, you know, one at a time to give them hope, to make them realize that what we've done in the past and what can be done now, they need to see themselves in this fight. So when they realize, again, what victory looks like. And again, also, it's for them, for somebody to go to sleep at night and say, did I do everything I could to make the world a better place? Did I do everything I could to ensure that we're gonna wake up tomorrow instead of from nuclear war? And if you can say yes to that, that's all, again, that's all you can do. So I won't ever tell an individual, this is what you need to do, because we're all so different. Again, some people, if you're a writer, then use that, right? If you're a computer person, use that. If you're a sculptor, then sculpt. You know, look what Keith Haring did. Look what this artist did. You know, use those things, the tools, the gifts you're given to save humanity. And that's what I would advise, you know, how we do it. So, but again, we've really got to work on the branding issue. You know, you look back at the Iran nuclear deal. Look at Global Zero's campaign. Now they had celebrities constantly speaking out in favor of the nuclear deal. That resonated with a lot of people. So again, and you saw the celebrities and how they were invested in the 1980s. So that again is something that we need to look at. So there's all different ways like that. I know we're getting short on time. And again, you have my information. So if there's any questions I didn't answer or anything that anybody wants to talk about, I'm pretty easy to find. And I'd be more than happy to continue the conversation with, whether it's individually or in a group setting.
Thank you, Dr. Intondi. This has been an amazing conversation. And I can't resist sliding in one last question from Isabel Williams here at the Nuclear Threat Initiative. Any thoughts on intersectionality in terms of other major global threats that people care about, principally climate change, also a social justice issue and a policy governance issue? Should we be trying to work more closely with the climate community?
Yes, I would. I think that tying in what happens when nuclear war, if it occurred, from the billions of people, you know, to what happens to the food, what happens to the climate, what happens to the environment. So yes, I think, you know, at the end of the day, what is the climate change movement trying to do? Keep us alive, save humanity. That's what we're trying to do, right? So I think we can learn from them what has worked and what hasn't. I think we should be working with them, but also with other movements as well. Black Lives Matter, I think we should be working with, you know, issues for equity. I think there's all these issues we should be working on together. But it's not, again, it's approach wise too. I will never tell one of my African-American students that you must be involved in this because it's the most existential threat in your life. It's not. Being killed by the police on the way to school is. So making sure, you know, and then tying that into the militarism of the police, right? There's the connection there. So again, it's thinking about how these connections, how we intersect, meeting them where they are is a big piece of this. Meeting them where they are is essential. And so, yes, I think that we should be working with these groups. I think we should be, and again, the more we could talk about the humanitarian consequences, what happens to the land, what happens to human beings, is going to be the most effective. Because, you know, I got started by hearing from the Hibakusha in Hiroshima, in Nagasaki, and seeing what the bomb actually did. And that fundamentally changed me. So I got a feeling that if we continue on that path, like Helen Caldicott did, we can once again fundamentally change some folks on how they're thinking about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Intondi, for an amazing and illuminating conversation. I've learned a ton. I'm very grateful for your time and also for your new book, Saving the World from Nuclear War, the June 12, 1982 Disarmament Rally and Beyond, available now from Johns Hopkins University Press. Thank you for joining us for this Nuclear Threat Initiative book talk with Dr. Vincent Intondi. Thank you.